Hi there, I'm Jason Hayes, Product Manager for Trimble RealWorks, and in today's video we're going to take a look at what's new in version 11.3. Now the very first tool we'll take a look at is the Wall Verticality Inspection Tool. Now you can see here I've selected a nice wall here in Scan Explorer. We're just going to take a look at those points over in the RealWorks 3D view. And inside the 3D view, along the top, we have a number of tabs. One of those tabs is the Inspection tab. And on that tab, you'll see the new Wall Verticality Inspection Tool. Once the tool opens, you'll see it looks a lot like the Floor Flatness Inspection. The first thing we need to do is define a plane. Now this can be at the bottom of the wall, maybe at the top, depending on what's more important. You can see we've got a good fit there. Now alternatively, you could also choose to fit the plane to the entire wall, like I've done here. Once I've defined my plane, the next thing I need to do is define an area that I want to do the inspection on. So I'm just going to click in the upper left corner, drag down to the lower right. Once I've defined that area, then I just need to click Done. Now the next thing, we could set a grid origin. It's already in the corner. That defines where our grid starts. We can also set a spacing for our grid. In this case, let's just set it to 150 millimeters. Now we'll talk about the grid a little bit more after we do our preview. The next thing that I need to do is I can go in and set an out of tolerance value. So in this case, let's just set this to, let's not do 5, let's do 4 millimeters. So we're just going to type in 4 here and then click on preview. Now everything within 4 millimeters of that plane is going to show up as a gray color. Let's just hide our point cloud. We'll get rid of our grid as well. So you can see most everything is within that 4 millimeters, that gray. But everything that's blue or red is one side or the other of the wall. Now let's take a look with the limit box just to see how this plane compares to the point cloud. Now I'm just defining this limit box to look at a gray area of the inspection map. And if I turn on the point cloud and we look, we can see that that plane is fitting right through the point cloud for the most part. That's everywhere that it's within 4 millimeters of that plane. Now, if we were to move the limit box over just to an area where we see some of that blue area and turn on the point cloud, now if we look at it, we'll see that that point cloud is deviating away from that theoretical plane that we created quite a bit there. As we get down closer to where it gets back to that gray color, we see the deviations a lot less. So it gives you a good idea of how the point cloud and that plane interact with each other. Now, another thing that you may want to do is export this information out. If we click on export, we'll just give it a name, Wall Verticality Inspection. We'll put it in a folder just because it's going to put a bunch of information in there. We want to keep it together. You can see it's going to make the inspection report package. We'll click save. It's going to automatically open up the report. It's in an RTF file format, so that allows you to go in and do some customization. You can add pictures, add your company logo. For example, I can change my name here, put it to Jason Hayes. And then I can scroll down, see general information. I can see that the grid spacing, I saw at the top what the units were. Here I can see, after that I can see volumes. It looks like I left it to gallons in my settings. I was doing tanks right before this, so it was a goof up. I can saw the areas. If I scroll over and zoom in, I can see that grid map that we were talking about earlier. So these are each of the grid points and the values plus or minus based on that plane. Now, if we open up that folder, you'll see inside there in that package all the things that were created. So in this case, if I just move this over, you can see that this is a JPEG of that inspection map. And if I zoom in, you can see the values there over here on the blue areas as well. So it's got a number of items in that report. Now the next tool we're going to take a look at is a tool that allows you to create a color layer with your inspection maps. So here I've selected two objects. I'm opening the Surface to Model Inspection tool. I've got a cylinder and a point cloud of a storage tank. And you'll notice over here in step two, we have the option to create a color layer with the current point cloud rendering. So let's just click preview. And we'll take a look at how this looks once the inspection map is created. Now, while it's processing, like I said, whatever point cloud rendering you have displayed when you click preview, that's what this color channel is going to use. So you can see here our inspection map has our normal inspection map colors, but we also have this color channel option. So if we turn that on, we can see now, because I had true color rendering from my point cloud, I can see the true color. So I can see things like these black and white targets that were taped onto the side of this storage tank. Now, if I was to look at this same area with normal point cloud inspection map rendering, I wouldn't see those targets. So by having this true color rendering, I can see other items that gives me context of what's going on. Now, in addition, I can also use blending. So you can see here, it's at 100%, but if I change it to something like 75%, then I can see the inspection map colors, but I can also see a hint of that true color, just enough to give me context to see where I am on this inspection map. Now, the next thing I want to do is I'm just going to go ahead and create this and then close the tool. Now, if I export this, I'm just selecting that inspection map, going to the export and choosing export inspection map. We'll just give it a quick name and we'll click save. You can see that we now have the option to export that color layer as well. So this next tool is in the mesh creation. So I've gone to the surfaces tab, selecting mesh creation. And if we look up here in the upper right of the tool, we can see there's a lot of points. There's 795,000 points. But you see in step three, we have a lightweight option and a high detail. So if I click on preview mesh with it set on that high detail, let's just see what that looks like. So we're just going to speed this up a little bit. It's gone through now and it's created the mesh. And we can see there's a lot of triangles. There's over 1.5 million triangles. So let's move over to lightweight. I'm just going to hide the point so you can see the mesh. It's a good looking detailed mesh as you would expect. But now let's go ahead and click preview with it on that lightweight setting. So we're just going to click preview mesh. And again, sped this up a little bit so you don't have to sit here and watch it create that. And once it creates this mesh, now you can see we've also got a very nice looking mesh, keeping a lot of detail, but you'll notice that the number of triangles is less than half of what it was before. So a great feature to create much lighter weight meshes that can be consumed in a lot more software packages. All right, so we've created a nice looking mesh here. The next thing that you would naturally do is go in and do some edits on it. So if we go up to the Surfaces tab, you'll see the Mesh Editing tool. We'll just launch that. And if you look up here in the right, quite a bit has changed. Now, if you forgot to reduce the size of it when you created it, we've got a number of options to reduce those sizes of mesh here. In addition, you can fill holes. So maybe you see some small holes in your mesh, you want to fill those, click the Fill Holes button. Move your mouse over the hole, it's going to highlight the border with that yellow color, and then just click to fill it in. So for example, if we look over here at another area, I'm just going to highlight it by moving our mouse over it and then click to fill it in. Now if we rotate around and look at it, you can see it's not just applying a flat plane across there, it's trying to apply some smarts to look around the area, what's going on, and fill it in a little bit more naturally. So some great tools in the mesh editing for filling holes and reducing triangles. So now that leaves me with just two more highlights that I want to show you. This next one has to do with modeling, steel beams specifically. So if we open the Steelworks tool, you'll notice up here, I'm just going to make sure there's a catalog selected. We have this new option to do automatic extraction. So I'm just going to use the segmentation tool. I'm just going to quickly segment around this I-beam, close the segmentation tool, and then I'm just going to click extract. Now the software is going to run through that library that I selected and look through the best shape, could be an I-beam, an H-beam. You can select the best shape and the best size and fit it to the point cloud. So we can see there, it looks like a great fit. Now we still also have the options to do it the old way with the manual drawing. So I can come in here, select a shape. Now I don't have a library, I'm just quickly drawing a shape to it, not taking a lot of care. And it's just going to create an extruded model there. Now the next thing I can do, this new option, is to click adjust, and it's going to move that model to be a best fit on that point cloud. So two new ways to go through and create these steel beams, automatic fitting or adjusting a manual drawing. All right, so we've made a lot of improvements in this release, but there's just one last highlight I'd like to show you. It's for those that are working on tunnels. And here's a standard tunnel, and a lot of times in tunnels you'll have tripods or people walking by, things that you want to remove so that you can really look at the tunnel envelope. So in this case, we've added a new classification. I'm just going to select this tunnel, and then I'm going to go up, make sure I'm on the Edit tab, and then here's this new option you'll see here called Auto Classify Tunnel. So I'm going to select that. I've got a few options here, Tunnel Envelope, Everything Else, and Ground. In this case, we're just going to leave the ground turned off, and then we're just going to click Extract. Now this is a pretty small section of tunnel, so it won't take too long to do the classification. Now you can see here, it's done a really nice job of identifying that tunnel envelope, cleaning it up. And if I come over here, you'll see there's the new object tunnel envelope, and there's also this new item called Remaining. If I turn that on, I can see that tripod and a few other things that the software didn't think were part of the tunnel envelope. Now, let's also take a look at, we'll just run it again and see what it does if we include ground on there this time. So again, we're going up to the Edit tab, choosing Auto Classify Tunnel, clicking Ground, just going to run it one more time. And now this time it's created the tunnel envelope. It's also created this ground layer as well as the remaining. So if we look through here, now we can see our envelope and the ground both classified independently. So a great tool for those of you working in tunnels to go through and help clean them up. Doesn't have to be a straight shot like this. They can be curved tunnels as well. So as you can see, in this release of Trimble RealWorks, we've added new features and enhancements to improve your productivity and make your deliverables stand out like never before. I hope you've enjoyed today's video, and as usual, I look forward to seeing you in the next one. Thanks for watching.